We had tried our best to, quote, get enlightened on our own and realized we didn't have it. We couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. So I knew I needed a teacher, but at the same time, I wanted a custom-made design teacher to my fantasies, right? I didn't want the real teacher. My grandmother taught me how to pet cats. When you pet cats, you start at their head and you go back, and then they go. But if you go this way against their fur, they. So this teacher rubbed the wrong way. He rubbed my fur the other way from the tail forward. And I was like, you know, and I just, you know, why don't you just rub me so I purr? And he said, basically, he said, you've had too many people rubbing you that way. And you've surrounded yourself with people that give you honey and sweet talk. And he said, as a result, you're really confused and you can't grow. So he would rub the wrong way. And the first way, of course, he rubbed was my first week there, where he just out of the blue made this 5-minute commentary on arrogance and people who think they know everything and therefore their vessels are already full, they can't put anything in, and how pathetic. They come to the mountain jewels, leave empty-handed, and it's like, oh, he's talking to me. Then that was the breakthrough that allowed me to say, if there's somebody who knows me better than I know myself, he could be my teacher. Yet I resisted. You know, the traditional thing would be to bow, and I didn't want to bow. So I told you the story. I stayed in the back of the group. Everybody was around the master talking, and I was 6 rows deep back, and I looked left and right, and I went, you know, did a bow, came up, you know, did another bow, came up. You have to do 3 bows to show you're sincere. And I thought, good, I got away with it. Nobody's seen that I'm bowing. He doesn't even know I'm bowing to him. It's like, yeah, I'll have this secret teacher, you know. And third bow, I go down. When I come up, the whole line is split open. He's sitting there in his chair. He had parted the crowd, so they had a direct avenue right to me. And I go, oh, and I'm blushing and whatnot. And then he just says, you know, how does it feel? Does it hurt? And and as a result of that, that was the first encounter. But I must say, I went on testing. I'd look for any sign of greed, any sign of an emotion that wasn't completely under his control, any sign of having an eye for something. I mean, it was just so subtle. Did he look, somebody made an offering, did he look at that with a kind of fondness or pleased? A red envelope came in, did he look and see how much money was inside? Incredible offerings were made to him. Did he, you know, categorize his offerings? I just went through everything. Was there any inconsistency in anything he ever said? You know, I was just quick to get on it and nail it. And as much as I thought I could find something, I never found anything. And I kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And I think probably that's the most important factor in my heart opening up. Was the trust. And it wasn't a blind trust, but it was a trust that was tested. I had to test this. But it was also his ability to respond to me without me asking that really opened it up. He just kind of was there at the right time with the right words. And then, most importantly, nothing in return. Not a single thing did he ask in return, which is what I was expecting. Even the fact that I want to leave home or something, he had no interest in amassing a group of disciples. And so if you wanted to leave home, you didn't want to leave home. As Dharma Master Chur was saying last night, she wrestled 8 hours whether to take the precepts. And she finally goes and says, I think I want to take, okay, you know, fine. It was like, and the same thing happened to me. I thought, okay, I think I'm going to leave home. And a big fanfare, and I go up to meet with him, and you know, he's having his lunch, and Master Hua, I think I want to leave home. And he's like, think you want to leave home? What do you mean, think? And he's eating lunch, and I think, well, I'm waiting for him to say, oh, that's really wonderful. Look at special disciple wants to leave home. And he says, you know, pastor, so he saw us. Well, he says, why are you asking me? Huh? What? Well, I thought, he says, you thought, you don't think about leaving home. You either leave home or you don't. What do you, you know? He says, are you thinking about eating? He's food. He said, no, you eat food and then you're full. You don't eat. And so he gave this analogy, and I was like, wow, he doesn't even want me. I'm really special. And it's like there was the arrogance again and the whole thing. So that was another test, because you could think, oh, he's got bright young American disciples. This will look good for him. I can remember once here in Malaysia, we went to visit a monk in a cave. As he was touted as being a real cultivator. But then as we were walking into the cave, I saw the extension cord going into the cave. So we got into the cave on the hillsides, and there's a nice refrigerator there and a heater, you know. It was a pretty comfortable cave. And I could see Master Hua just coming in smiling, you know. And then he said, oh, Master Hua, you're the great, you know, Dulun Fashir. You've got all these American disciples and da-da-da in these temples and so forth. And he was sort of saying, must be hard to cultivate with all of that. And Master Hua, without even batting an eye, said, I could put it all down like that. It doesn't mean a thing to me. He said, but what if I pulled your extension cord? And then the guy relaxed and sort of laughed a little and thought, oh, I've been had. You know? So there was none of that. And every time I saw that, I realized I had someone really true. And I must say, I've never met anyone who was so true. Now, I met people, obviously there's a lot of true people, but there's always a little tarnish in the gold, you know, and sometimes a lot of tarnish and a little gold. But even the best people I met, and some I considered like my grandfather, one of those persons, that trueness wasn't complete as his was. He truly, truly sought nothing. I mean, I can't think of anybody I've met who didn't seek something, even at the most subtle. I met really deep cultivators who were still seeking nirvana or seeking bodhi or seeking some special spiritual state. He absolutely had a vibe of he didn't seek anything, and he was totally okay with that. We're driving to LA. I'm just digressing. We're driving to LA in a car. We get a flat tire. And Heng Sure and I are with the master, and we're trying to think, well, what are we going to do? Somebody stops and says, you need some help. And we say, well, you've got a flat tire. Can you drive us to the gas station? And Sherpa says to Heng Sure, and I says, you two go together. Because, you know, as you travel in pairs at your young age, you know, you never know what's going to happen. Well, we're going to leave you here alone. Yeah, I'll be okay. Really? You're gonna be? Yeah, I'll be. Don't worry. And we're on 5-8. Is it 5? Well, no, Highway 5? Is that the I-5, right? In the middle of nowhere, out there, and there's no water, there's no food, the broken down car. And so I'm thinking, oh, what's going to happen? He doesn't speak English. He's out there on the highway alone. You know, be nervous or whatnot. We drive down, we get the tire, we come back. As we're coming back, I'm looking on the hillside, and there he's just sitting in lotus position with a little smile on his face, this wavy dry grass is going, completely at ease. Oh, you're back already. Okay. You know, no nervousness, not anxious, not hailing down anybody, just being who he was. So that kind of relaxed me into both taking him as a teacher and as a model. And that became very clear that I was seeking all the time. Always seeking, always after something, and, you know, not able to let that mind go to rest. That, I guess, is how the relationship changed. And it changed from skepticism to distrust to trust and confidence in. And at the same time, I don't say we ever got closer. This is really a funny thing. You think with time, with relationship, you get closer. I got closer to my true self. I didn't get closer to him. To this day, I don't know who he was or what that was about. I really can't say I knew Master Hua. But I got to know myself a little bit better through that encounter. And maybe there wasn't any Master Hua to know. Maybe truly that's what no self means. He was a person without a self. You know, there was a there's an expression, a person of the way with no mind. And that was it. You encountered him, and it was just a gateway into all sorts of things. But you'd say, where was he? And that's why he said, I came from empty space, I returned to empty space. What did he mean by that?
所以我常常对人说，我没出家以前，我的名字呢有个假名字，叫什么白中医，那时候以为，哦，我是中国第一人，这个名字很好的，又一想，这个名字又有什么呢？在什么地方呢？没有，所以那时候又叫活死人，以后就叫活死人，这活的这个人呢已经死了。 这还是个假名字，以后又守孝呢，一般人又称说这是白孝子，这还是个假名字。那么出家的名字呢叫安慈，以后叫杜伦，现在又选了话，这通通都是假的。那么究竟真的名是什么呢？我的真的名字就叫众生，这是我一个真的名字。 再还有一个真的名字叫佛，为什么呢？众生可以成佛，我将来等到一切众生成佛了，我就成佛。你说这个名不对吗？我又要叫心，因为众生和佛都没有除去你这一念心，所以这个心这也是我一个真名字。心佛即众生，世三无差别。 这三个没有什么分别，所以这三个是我的真名字。你们要找众真，你们师父是谁？说哦，我们师父就是众生，我们师父是谁？是佛，我们师父是谁？是我们的心。除了这三个，那都是假名字。这三个你要指着他是真的吗？那也又错了，也不是真的。
就好像我告诉那个白胜法师说是，我说我这个卡片上有三个名字，一个安慈，一个杜伦，一个选化，但是这三个名字哪一个名字也不是我的真名字。什么是我真的名字呢？虚空。我真的名字就是虚空。